gonna do something. And they say, who's modern technology stuff? One day, the moon is about. I said that next quote, y'all, I'm gonna hear it. That's what we're gonna be talking about today. How y'all doing?
All right.
You know, I've been gone and out of pocket for a minute, but I'm refreshed and new restored, amen. I'm sure getting to tell y'all while I was gone. I heard about it, y'all know I did. So I wanted to touch bases on what God is speaking in the atmosphere on this morning. Even while I was away, he was dealing with about some things. And if you got the weapons, I ain't waiting for long. You got all your information right here. We're going to stand the reading of his word. Jeremiah 29 and 11. And some of us probably need to hear this. Now, we got some things going on, and this ain't going quite like we want. And we feel like we should know, because we are who we are. As we go forward, God, the Heavenly Father, I want to thank you right now as we go deep into your word, God. Search us, O Lord, give us the wisdom, the knowledge, and understanding to be able to obtain your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen. Today's topic is stay with the plan. Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, declared the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. You may be seated. That's all we're going to do right now. I was sitting here thinking about it as I went to my journey, I had my fraternity, we had our district conference, which everybody in the state of Mississippi comes to this conference to find out more about what's going on with our fraternity, the meeting things, and actually for our district leaders to roll out what the plans for the next couple of steps of our fraternity. So dealing with that and coming back here, you know, we're getting ready for our founders, we come August, and I was just sitting here. As we met a couple at the beginning of the year back there on a Wednesday, and we talked about it another Wednesday. We've been plotting, planning, and all this other stuff, and God was giving to me. Don't you know, when you're in his plan, ain't nothing fail.
Amen.
I don't care who, what, when, where, come your way, or who whispers sweet nothings in your ear, God's plan is going to prevail. Now, the point is that we have to understand, us being utensils being used, we got to understand we got to go through some things. Now, didn't he say a couple of weeks ago, a couple of Sundays ago, the spirit of you? Don't y'all know when you make Kool-Aid, I'm bringing it home. When you make Kool-Aid, I just made some yesterday. No, I ain't need it, but hey, it just tempted. It's been in the refrigerator for I don't know how long. But I began to pour that sugar in the cold water. You know, sugar don't dissolve in cold water real quick. So I'm getting mad. I taste the bitterness, then I taste a little bit of the sugar. I said, no, it don't make no sense. Because I wanted the cold. But as I sat there and went on and came back maybe an hour or two, and it really had dissolved, and I began to taste, and I could taste it was coming together, but I had to put something in it to stir it up. And when I stirred it up, guess what, y'all? Woo! It's like Mama Kool-Aid, which used to make it back in the day. Of course, I had me a couple of cups or gallons of whatever you want to call it. It's gone now. I'm good. Don't be fussing about your weight and all that. But it takes preparation and plans. And if you hadn't read God's word, which is the preparation part, you ain't going to understand the plan. And if you're down in the dumps and it's the only time you want to ask God for help, that ain't no plan. You're looking out for a handout. Uh-oh. I want to come clear with you. That is a handout. And see, sometimes God don't remove us from that situation because we have learned our lesson. We want everything to go our way when we want it, how we want it, whenever we want it. That's just how it is. And that's how some of us Christian folks are. Christian folks. They talk about us and talk about the folks over there. We want it when we want it. And if it ain't going our way, we're going to pout. We're going to complain. We're going to talk about everything and everybody. And going to make everything like it's going against us when it's actually us. So when we're looking at God's plan, he said, he was talking to Jeremiah, he said, for I know the plans I have for you. Declare who? The Lord. Plans to what? Prosper you. Now I'll tell you right now, I told you last year when he showed me this, if you ain't ready, then this is not your season. But if you have dropped everything and cleaned out your house, and as Gab mentioned, it ain't how it's what supposed to look like, or it ain't what it's looking like, you're going to be walking in some plans this year, because this is the year of favor. Uh-oh. 2018, here we go. that he's going to be rolling out things like you've never seen before. Now, I've been already a witness, and I don't know about some of y'all. I wish I could give y'all a testimony right quick. It ain't done yet. It ain't done yet. He is truly uttering everything that has proceeded out of my mouth. Now, what we got to understand, out of my mouth, I'm not being greedy. I'm not saying, okay, Lord, I want a new car, I want an airplane, I want a new house. I'm not saying all that stuff. I'm truly just walking my little diligent self along the way. And as I see, say, God, you know, that would look good right here, or I might need this, or I wish I could have, or I wish the church can have. Don't you know God is on this thing? I want to take you down here real quick when it's talking about the plan. Plan is something written, but it's sealed and signed by whoever the orchestrator is. That means there's a step, there's instructions, there are things that you need in this plan to succeed. So let's go down here. I took Radical this morning for an example. Radical plan. You know, he represents us in five. That's our number. That's our number five. So if you're ever going anywhere and you don't know what's going on, you just mention five. What are you talking about? Well, that's our church. That's what we're going with, five. I was just talking to another pastor the other day. And he was like, oh my God, I'm just thinking about you, Pastor. He said, I'm about to call you, but I came off and got out of work. And he got your number in my phone. He said, don't you know God is dealing with me and my ministry in fives? He said, I want to talk to you about that. How is that working for you? I said, man, it's just nice. So we looked at this act we talked for a minute. We was birthed August 5th, 2013, in Robertsdale, Mississippi, doing a revival at Pastor Bingham Church, God People Unity. That's when God wouldn't let me go any further. I couldn't get up, I couldn't move, I couldn't. So I got that off of my chest. It was brief. 5 months later, y'all see this now? 5 months later, if you want to count from August to January 5th was our first service. Christmas Street. That was the very first service. Now, if you look on down, some 20 months later, August 5th, 2017, we begin our $7 sacrificial offer. Y'all applied. Y'all didn't say, oh, I ain't going there. I ain't got no money, whatever. We did what you could. Now, look at this. August 5th. 2018 will be our 5th year founding day, which perhaps landed on a Sunday. Ain't that miraculous? I didn't plan this. God has told me to breathe it there. I was lost after that. Everything that proceeded out of my mouth was instructions from him on high. Won't he orchestrate you and make you feel like you really know a whole lot? I don't know a whole lot, y'all, but with his help and his strength and his wisdom and the knowledge that he's given me, I've learned that to trust God's plan and not mine, because back up in here, I had a lot of whispering ears, if y'all don't understand, saying, you can get a building, you can go and get a loan for a church, you can get this, and I'm sitting there going, what in the world? But I'm glad God showed me stuff before he asked me. See, it's a thing called a dream that he gives you. You read it back. Who got that spiritual warfare about? Who got the spiritual warfare? You got yours. Turn to 1195. I want you to hear something. 1195. Read that part about turn a deaf ear to negativity. I want y'all to hear this.
Turn a deaf ear to the negative. Quit listening to negative people. For thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, do not let your prophets and your diviners, who are in your midst, deceive you. Nor listen to your dreams, which cause you to be dreamed.
Don't listen to your who?
Dream.
How about them dreams?
Which you cause to be dreamed. For they prophesy falsely to you in my name. I have not sent them, says the Lord. Jeremiah 29:89. If God has given you a dream, you can almost count on someone coming along to speak gloom and doom over it. A sure way to look to the future with hope is to ask God what he wants to do in your life. Get a sure word from him, and then hold on to your dream. Refuse to listen to dream killers.
Ain't that something? Ain't that something? Regardless of the situation that happened to me, because it wasn't about me once I realized it, it was a part of the plan. Once I got the concept and I started moving forward, God breathed this. And in between all that, here comes the group. dream killers. Get this, get that. Well, you ought to have this. Or you ought to do this. You ought to do that. And I'm listening to all this. Don't get me wrong. Some of these people I would call are reliable sources that I consider friends to say, hey, jump out there and do this. But I'm thinking about what God is trying to get this thing going. See, you got to understand something. When there's a plan, and it always going back to plans, that plan got a planter, and you have a planner. I was the planter of the planter. He planted the seed radical in the ground. I had nothing to do with what went on the ground. I had nothing to do with that seed. He planted that seed underground. My job was to watch it grow. Now it's growing. It's growing. It's growing. But see, this is what we get dismayed about these dream killers. People are coming. We went to a conference, last year, and we're talking about who we are, who we represent. The first question came out, I want to pass them out. Well, how many members you got? I was sitting there looking like, ooh, wow, this one, they've got a conference, okay? I said, we're small, we're grown. Well, you know, I took over church, had maybe about 18 people, and now about 6 months later, we had like 1,000. Like, wow, amazing. I said, well, God bless you. But this is what gets me. God always sets you up. He wanted me to hear that, but we got in our senses, and we started talking about healing and restoration and all this other stuff and divine. The question came up out of your thousand, how many saved? Woo! See, you can have a room full of people, but have no kind of churching going on. You can have a whole big building, and it ain't worth the value that they built it off. You got to have stability, solidarity, and you got to have the anointing God have placed on your. It's going back into that seed. What he had in that seed is going to come up. Now, everybody aim to come touch this plant. Someone's going to look at it and come jump in here, but it ain't funny. You got to jump back out because this is not where you're supposed to be at. You're supposed to be on a corn row. This is the growth row. You're on a corn row where corn starts. You know, you ain't ready. You just want to peek through the and see what's going on. God is placing some ministries across this nation, across this world that are coming up. And my thing is, when the dream killers come, where your people at? You know, we're human, when you go places and you get invited to go, you expect your, as they say, entourage to come in, your whole church people and all this other stuff. You're looking out there. But I'm reminded, I'm glad I listened when I was little, because mama will knock you out if you did. They used to have a thing come out, if I have to go, I'll go by myself. I'm glad I listened to that song. Because when I got there, God said, this is about me and you. Matter of fact, it ain't about you. I just need you here to be a mouthpiece. So when I got there, it was like amazing how God moved on the house. Then I go to the next event, and if I have one or two out there, then God still will move on the house. This is what you have to understand. In the midst of your plan, you're going to have some people out you to build. That's one thing we got to understand. Quit talking about your plans to everybody. Because everybody is not a planner. Uh-oh. Oh, my God. Woo! I don't know what happened, but I'm just using the example. You plan to go somewhere, and you done planned, got some money right, and made the reservations and all this stuff, and you done told everybody, I'm going to take off from work, and I'm going to do this. I got a couple of days. So, and then right up when it's time for you to leave, something come up, your boss said you can't go. What you mean I can't go? I got a day. When you leave, you'll get fired. You done told a dream killer who done got into somebody's ear to block what's going on with you. Let me go back even further. I was listening to these people talk about, you know, we did the demonstration a couple weeks ago about how you get in the lines of the prophets. And then the prophets side, you're about to tell you some money you already got. Right. And you know you need a whole lot more, but you want to sit here and you come out. Well, I'm stepping out on faith. I'm going to take the elf off of you, eight. Atheist does crazy stuff. When you step out on faith, you just stand up there like a, what they say, a loose deer in the middle of the road. You done gave your last meal money, your last bill money to somebody who you ain't gonna see no more probably, and they probably live 3,000 miles away, sitting in their house counting your ducks. Saying, I wonder how many doubles did I got this go around here. And some of them gotta understand that they're using prophetic, they won't be just a nice one. Well, you know, it's coming. Where's your faith at? You ever realize how sometimes they're twisted back on you, even what they spoke didn't come to? Well, it's something you know. what time it is. It was never when I came up here the first time. I'm trying to see what I'm not supposed to be doing versus what I need to be doing. But anyway, you know, you lost your money. Your prayers don't go according to. And that's what we got to understand, even in this season. I don't care if you owe $10 or $10 million. You need to plan every penny that God has blessed you with where it needs to go in this season. I don't care if cousin so-and-so need a little handout. Don't you know cousin so-and-so need a handout last year and the year before last? What made you think you Captain Save? I want to say that word so bad. Oh, my God. You got to get to the part of understanding where God is trying to take you. And I believe, honestly, out there, I didn't listen to none of these little folks or dream wishes that we're still here where we at. We moved from that building to this location. Still nice. And God has worked it out where we're affordable, and he's doing what he needs to get done. But even in the midst of planning this conference, we hear about them. I said, that ain't going to happen. Y'all too small to have it. What small got to do when God said, just do this? It has nothing to do with small. He didn't tell Tyler Prayer, go get you 15 people to coach you to acting. He took his grandmama and his aunt situation and put it on TV, and now he's the richest man that controls TV. Now, we get it twisted. We got to worry about what the government doing, who going to help us, who going to assist us. If God gave you the dream, don't you know we already sent people your way? And reason you don't need them because you're too busy. Listen to the dream killers. You poor men over here, downtown Cleveland. You over here in the Eastgate trying to sit there and talk about good numbers. I don't know why. Leave these folks alone. They don't want to go nowhere. Let them stay where they at. And if God ain't going to tell you to bring them up, then you reach back and give them. This is what we're missing. So in the midst of all my dream killers, I didn't listen. And now we're rolling out our Founders Week. See how good God is when he's talking about planting. He's the planting. I'm the planter. He planted. He said, go over the 5 days. Five again. August 1st on a Wednesday. August 5th on a Sunday. Everything that has been orchestrated, don't you know it has been falling in place? Let me give you a little whiff of it now. This is sound news for me, Pastor. When you start planning stuff, even as, you know, even if you ain't on the committee, you the pastor, you still want to make sure everything is correct with him. I don't care how close you to these people. I don't care if that's your sister cousin and she got a grammy. I don't care. God said, no. The pastor says, no. So we've been sitting here just brainstorming and I'm just walking around, bobbing my head. Y'all know I like a little ball. God, who these people need to be in these spots? The first thing he spoke to me, people who have supported me. Ain't that something? I'm going to come on here. People who have supported. See, I learned the trend of the traditional way. Preachers bring in preachers with big churches, so they bring in big money. I ain't looking for no big money. Because one person walks through that door and give me $15 million. And I'll fall out, and y'all have to leave me here to probably next year because I ain't going to believe it. Every time I get up, one person can do your ass of $15 million. So I ain't worried about the big preachership. If you didn't come by and say, hey, how y'all doing? Do y'all need anything? I see y'all growing. Can I help any? I ain't hear none of this stuff from a lot of these folks right here. So he said, go back to the people who have supported you. That means when I was planted in the ground, it was some people came and pulled that dry rye up from around that seed when they saw it coming. And some people came and watered it a little bit, bring a little water. So this, in the midst of all these years, we had some help and some resources that came to help us out. So I began to think, and it wasn't hard because it ain't that many, but I began to think. And we got on to the point. I don't know if y'all remember Dr. Corey Murphy, who came one Sunday, very educational, very dignified, very political, analytical education. You had to write all his stuff down because he'll take you there, but he's talking some good stuff. He'll make your mind wonder, like, is I'm an educated fool or is I just need to go back and just research? That's how his ministry flows. He's going to challenge you in the mind about Christ. You got people like me, I'm on porch. I'm going to say, yup, nope, yep, and all that. Same thing, we're talking about Christ. But he's going to come on Wednesday. He's coming on Wednesday to do our kickoff for our radical works. We're going to have it right here. And see, when God does it, he know your situation. He know how much money in your pocketbook. He know what's going on. We ain't broke, y'all. I promise you we ain't broke. people are not being broke. But at the same time, he still wanted economically, he still wanted to the point where you're going to prosper you. Uh-oh. He come on Wednesday. Thursday is the radical new, radical night out, radical youth night out. We already got most of that stuff done. Talk to Minister Gant. We're talking to our youth leader sitting over here. Kind of brainstorming, and even at the same time today we were talking about it, he sat there and wrote a whole page of the last Sunday I was here. So let me know God in trust me in some kind of way. God know how to do it though. That night they would be out at Harmony's Bowling Alley where they would kick off a little word session and have some fellowship. And I already got two churches that already came on board that don't support them, but they just heard me talking about it. Said, we want to be involved in that. Send us some information. Well, it's going to be the back room. I don't know if y'all ever been to Bowling. There's a back room back there that has a lot of more other stuff that we don't know about. They have counters and lounges and TVs and everywhere you play video games and all kind of stuff. They even have pool tables and stuff like that. That's where they set up a lot of the food. So you're going to have food galore back there and all kind of activities after the spoken word go forward and whatever they're going to do. Then they're going to come out into a bowling tournament. And it's going to be every church that's in Mecca have five team members. $10 a piece, $50. This is what we're looking at. You bowl two games, and top winners in the sport will win trophies from first, second, third on down. And we even talked, I talked to my fraternity, but guess what? They said, why we can't be involved? I said, well, we can include y'all as young adults. So they said they wanted to get a team. You see how God woke this thing up? And we ain't looking at the fact that it's monetary thing, but God said, I will supply all of your needs according. So I went and talked with the owner, and I don't know if he favors me or what, but he said, just let us know what you need to do that day so we can get everything blocked off. As y'all know, my birthday last year, he brought food to my free. But so I ain't did nothing with this man. I ain't sat down with no plans, nothing. He's just spirit, try spirit, by spirit. And he ain't black. He's whatever nationality he is. So we don't talk the same language, but we meet in the middle when it comes to Christ. So it's to the point where all that's been taken care of. Then we come down here on Friday where there's the South Spoken Word / Comedy Show. So I'm talking about we got five acts already that came on board and all of them said free. We got two coming from Chicago. Y'all know that ain't free. But they said they're going to get themselves down here because they owe it to this ministry. This ministry have spoken to their lives for along the way, and they feel they're obligated to do this at least one thing. I said, oh my God. So we got two comedians coming that way. Last night I talked to Be Real Steve. Anybody heard of Be Real Steve? Stephen Gill. I mean, he is so gifted and poetic when it comes to spoken word. He's in Huntsville, Alabama, written from Cleveland. Called him last night. That's the preacher said God is dealing with him in fire in ministry. He said, I would love to come. Matter of fact, I'll already be in town. I'll be doing my brother's wedding on that Saturday, so I'll be able to be there on that Friday. I said, well, how much to charge? He said, man, I owe your ministry. Oh, my God, there go again. See, we got to sit. We sit here trying to fall. And at first, I got to admit, I'm looking for people like Captain Taylor and Tim Rogers and all these folks. But God said, that's way, that's way. Because guess what? When I think about that, God said, yeah, to meet with some producer gal or somebody who's on the radio who know all these people already. So we lined up to have a concert, y'all, this little small ministry. We all see it, talking about concert, Captain Taylor, Tim Rawl, and all these other, the Clarksons. We're going to get ours in, too. I promise you we're going to get ours in. But it's to the point, we got to follow the plan, got to follow the plan. So all that has come on, he said, if you need any more acts, I can get something to this devil class. He said, we're going to make that life successful. I'm like, oh, my God. Then Gant was talking to the people at the Grand Museum. Y'all know they got a sound stage over there. Real nice set up there. Again, all you got to do is walk in. I thought we got access to it now. So the company show is at the Grand Museum. We just got to go block what we need to block and do. God, if you just stay tuned to what he got going on and quit, like he just read, listen to the naysayers. They don't want you to prosper. They don't want you to have your son. They don't want you to. I'm trying to tell you. Misery loves. And as soon as they see you doing good, guess what they're going to do? That's supposed to be me. I'm supposed to have it. That's mine. I just let you borrow it. This is the kind of stuff that we have coming our way. That's why all that people let me borrow. I don't want none of your fucking people. I ain't got it, I don't want it. God ain't give it to my ass. Don't be no, he said, you are the lender and not the, oh my God. I'm going down to Saturday is a gala. It's something they call buckskill. Big churches have galas. Small churches don't have no gala. We got about 5, 6, 7, 8, 10 people. You have two tables. It's in the middle of the street and had that. But we have a gala. This is what he laid out for me to do. The gala. And I was thinking, God, who are we going to get to come in here? I started coming up with some names and some stuff. He said, go back to who has supported you. He kept bringing me back to that. I'm telling you. That's who I talked to him yesterday, y'all. Pastor Lisa Day is coming in the house on that Saturday. We're going to do the gala. And guess what we have in there? At the Baptist State Alumni House. You see how all this stuff that we've been... You see the other big churches doing in this, but we're small. And people outside, we're at the Baptist State Alumni House. And she said, I'm going to have to behave, Pastor. I said, no, ma'am. You come as God see fit.
Right.
So we'll be sitting there in our black bougie attire. Y'all know how it is. Your little gowns and stuff. The homeless stuff. Yeah, I got a bus. And showcase some of her stuff. Or somebody walk out with something on. Or maybe she'll wear it or something. I don't know. But this is a night of elegance. A night of just giving back. And you're eating. And you get spiritual food at the same time. Yes, it's a cost to it, but we're going to work all that out. God's doing what he's doing. Amen. But at the same time, I said, we're going to do the food. He said, you got staff. Why you don't think they going to do it? Okay. I'm looking at him like, oh, my God, I ain't thought about them. So he just pretty much laid out everything that we need and that we're asking for. I got somebody already meeting me about booklet ads and stuff like that who's going to do the print. I talked to my chef, Peter. In Memphis about other foods and stuff like that. A lady named Latisha Roy from Drew was talking to me about decor and all. He's out here sending folks your way. In the midst of the plans that he have already given you. And then we looked at the fact on that Sunday. I was going to go to 2, but I was talking to Apostle Ben on yesterday. We're just going to have one service on Sunday, y'all. We already going to be drugged and moved. So Sunday going to be one service that's going to be pushed back to like 10 o'clock. We're going to come in, we're going to do all the installation and services all in one rib. So God has just showed us through this whole thing, this whole map blueprint, all this right here that has been saw in a dream, spoken, and now it came to pass. So ain't no turning back now. It's to the point that if you don't understand what he's doing in his ministry corporately, you never understand what he's going to do for y'all individually. Because when I tell you, I see blessings. I don't care what you come here complaining about. I listen to you right now, but I'm looking back there. I can see you, but I can see through you. This is what he's talking about. Same with my sister back there. She's in the warehouse. I'm like, okay, right here. I'm looking way past her. In the house. I know he says, oh, but that's a blessing.
Amen.
A blessing. But don't you know when God gives you something, you already know what's going to happen, don't you? Who we just talked about? The end will come. Because he's trying to prove to God you ain't who he said you are. See, there's one thing coming to church and you get to bless, then you go sit at home until you bless the world. No, you called, they called a dream killer. You became a dream killer. You took God's stuff and got blessed. Now you want to sit at home like you just really got it all in check. No, that's a continuation. It goes on and on. You come back to the forefront because guess what? When you sit at home, it's the very day the enemy said, I'm going to come pay you a visit. So whatever he didn't bless you with, the enemy comes and says, well, I'm going to tax you down because it ain't going to last long. So if you got some $10,000, but guess what? It's going to cost you $8 to get this, and it's going to cost you $1,600. Now you ain't got but $5 to spend. And you forgot you got to pay your utilities. So now you're looking at that. What happened to all that money? I'm looking at a lady in the road there that got blessed with this millions of, almost $10 million. She bought a land over there. She bought a building. She bought all her kids' cars. I mean, fast cars. She never know. that her discontinued going to church, because people ask, I don't need y'all. I mean, got to the point where she started raining up. Well, bring you up to par today. They have blocked all her money. Those cars her kids have, they have been repoed. All the stuff that she had bought has been frozen. And now she's sitting around there sick as a dog. So there's no stress will cause the sickness. Stress will bring stuff out that isn't supposed to come out. She's back to square one. Matter of fact, she lowered the square one. At least she had a job before all that hit. Don't play with God.
Right.
God ain't nothing to play with. I don't care how old you is or how young you is. You think you can, he don't care about your age. If he'll take an infant, he'll take a teenager. If he'll so take an elder or an adult. So he don't care about your age. Don't tell him. And you think he's lying? You ain't lying. He says, mark it in the book. I got you on this day. So when I come up your street, you're going to know it's me. Your mama can't get you out of it, your daddy can't get you out. That's what happens when kids get incarcerated, when they get in trouble, or when they get shot, or all this kind of stuff that's going on even today. We're not praying over our people like we should. And I ain't talking about just praying. Sometimes you got to pray and pull that joker to the table and say, sit down and listen to me. Because right now they think they got the upper hand because the enemy is doing his job. I wish I went across a sassy person. I tell you, I'm about this close from losing my job over there. Every time I walk towards a mouth that does this, I told them, walking in things, y'all just don't know. Let me creep up on you. I'm be like, they said, Jesus, I'm be like a thief in the night. I'm going to snatch your soul out of you. Because I got to bring you back to reality. You're not who you say you are. And if for you to get four, you got to get something in this empty space up here. Up than money, sex, and y'all know the other one. Money killing you, sex most definitely killing you. So what's left? Get your education, get on out of there, respect your parents so you can live. Because the scripture said, you start messing with your mom and daddy, you're cutting your days. I don't care if they're in your life or out of your life, that's what the scripture said. They ain't put a paper on my word, they got to be in my life. No, he said, do not curse your mom and dad. The day to be short. So we got to get to this place and understand it. God, if I'm going to live and die for you, I need to know the plan you have for my life. And he already told us, it's not to harm you. His plan is to give you hope in the future. A lot of us hoping that, when people ask you what you're going to be in life, I'm going to be an astronaut, I'm going to be there. That's a hope. But the plan is you got to make it come to fruition. I got on my phone, if you somebody look up Proverbs 13:16 for me. You about to get done. We're about done. I forgot to turn it in. Proverbs 13:16. I knew when I was little that my mom was a food server, my dad cooked. I wanted to go in that arena, but I watched them for years. I said, I don't want to be in that mess. That's how I was. I was saying, read, I still love food, but I didn't want to be in that mess. Look what happened. I got in food service. But I got on the business side. I'm still in food service. I expected to take me where I'm at, but it looked like it went like from here to here. I went from being a nobody trying to tell somebody about, well, y'all know how that sounds. I'm in a position now that I have a voice for the state. I'm meeting new people. I just met Nick Wallace, who was on CHOP. Y'all know that culinary competition show that be on TV on the network? And they have all these people come in competing who the best cook and all that. He just won last year, and he's from Mississippi, down in Evans, Mississippi. And I met him when I went on Mondays to judge the competition in Jackson. That's another connection. So I got a restaurant downtown. Come holler at me. And he's been emailing me, getting back and forth. God will put you in places that will last. Even though it happened today, that might come up later on where you might have to partner with somebody. Or it might be an idea somebody say, you know what, I met Miss Baskin 3 months ago. I like what we was talking about. Let me give her a call. You don't know how God is going to maneuver you in this plane. That's why we can't be towards negativity and all this other crap.
Right.
Listen to all these wishes and wails and all this other stuff. Well, I wish I had. Well, you keep wishing because this ain't a wish. This is God. Somebody got Proverbs 13:16.
Every prudent man acts with knowledge, but a fool lays open his folly.
Read that again.
Every prudent man acts with knowledge, but a fool lays open his folly.
What that mean, Miss again? Oh my God. Quit being around these foolish folks. It's a time to play and a time not to play. It's a time to do everything that's in the Bible. But when it comes to your plan, you got to be serious about it. Don't expect people to promote you. Promote yourself already. When I was sitting there dumping dishes and watching them trays out, I said, you know what, I'm going to be in that office. And every time I pass by, I said, I'll see you later on. Y'all thought I was playing. People thought I was crazy. Start speaking out with people listening. He's going crazy, y'all. He's talking about getting that off. It was just an empty office, but she had a lot of storage stuff in, junk and stuff. Could clean it out. But no. And even when he got to my boss, you know, she told me, Ed ain't gonna never graduate. He gonna do that. Y'all know how he do. He gonna do that. That's how to talk. I looked at her and said, wait a second. 8 months later after I graduated, I had to hit her first. I had to take her invitation. I sent her invitation to my graduation. 8 months later, see, this is how God's plan is. Before I graduated, I had a contract signed. Y'all missed it, didn't you? Y'all missed it. Y'all keep saying. Before I graduated, I signed a $37,000 contract to go to Atlanta, Georgia. To be a regular service manager. Regular service manager. In between that and getting to Atlanta, I got up to promotion. I became operations manager. 3 months being in Atlanta, I've been trying to find an apartment after two, finally moved in, and my niece can verify how she was there. Then I'm up trying to move again with another promotion after 3 months being in Atlanta. And I'm like, what in the what? I moved to Texas. 8 months later in Texas, I got promoted again to come back home. Ain't this so? And I sat there and I sat there. What is going on? I went from scraping dishes to overseeing three states, 11 colleges and universities, telling the big folks who was coaching me what to do and what not to do. Ain't that something? I was the youngest person in corporate at 23, walking through the back of doors, meeting with vice presidents and presidents and boards of universities, talking about food service. Ain't that something? Well, I got tired of that. Came back home, rained up state. I'm talking about the plan, y'all. They didn't even know it. I was coming back home because mom got sick. I wasn't studying on God. I had this Christian. But God always sets you up. When I did go look for a job, I'm looking for McDonald's and all this stuff. Before we even have me, I said, I got the condition. I reckon I'm overqualified. I don't know what that means. Sit on me. I'm in HR. Here we go. I'm in public school now. But I don't look back. When I first said I want to go into business, they had to understand. I wanted to own my own. Now look at the plan. God took me through a corporate sector. He took me through a private sector. He took me to the point where I had temptations of having my own catering company. So what did he do? He set me up. So I tell him now over there in Rome there, y'all can find me tomorrow, I'll be happy. But guess what? I'm gonna get my own. I got all the wisdom and the knowledge and all the understanding to step out again. So he showed me what I did with the catering company. My phone kept saying, you need 100K, you need this, you need that, you gotta have insurance. God said, I just need you to key it in on the state website that you want to become a business and you're doing business ads. Ain't that stuff? And when I did that, I was smooth sailing. Then he proved to me that was him. Went to church that Sunday. I remember I telling y'all this story. He come late, come on, do you do catering? Oh, I could have cut a flip. My first gig, I got 3 gigs out of. The second gig, I got 5 gigs out of. And it went on and on. So that period that I was just sitting at home, wasn't my mother coming after my mom had passed, I was doing good. That month in November, I'll never forget, I paid $21,000. I didn't tell everybody ever been asked for. $21,000, I did 2 caterings. When I paid all my bills, I still had like $11,000, $12,000, and that fed me a little bit more. So I really wasn't suffering God. God was just showing me and grooming me, because I still had mixed emotions about this and that. He's slowly but surely grooming you to get to where you've been asking him all along. That's why he sends dreams your way. And when dreams come, then you got to be able to be the visionary to pick up along the way something, everything you go through, whether it's good or bad, is to help you out later on. That's why now I'm trying to avoid negativity. I just stay away from it. Things are going to come my way that make I have employees saying this and accuse me of this. And that's fine. What you speak on is what you get yourself in. But as Yolanda Rash said, the late Yolanda Rash, if there's no wood, there's no fire. So why are you sitting there instigating, trying to fool yourself? You ain't in that. That's something that they mad about. Keep on walking. Keep on trucking. That's what I love about the plan. People going to hate you because you look like you got it all, or you have this nonchalant attitude. So what? God made you, not them. You be who you be. Don't sell yourself to anything less, and don't pull yourself to anything more. Just stay with the plan. Talk about your hope and talk about a future. I look at this young man. I think he's from Cleveland. You know by the name of Jamal, or whatever. And he's with this company. He started when he was 22, 23. And it's called Forex. I watched it all last night. And this young man, who's been throwing numbers out ever since he was little with some group of his friends while he was in high school. He went on to Alcorn, he went on to, I think, Jackson State. Guess what he's doing right now at the age of 24? Making six figures. He said his birthday, he said this November, when it rolls over, he's going to ask his mom to retire from her job and pay for everything. 24 years old. Ain't this something? He saw the plan. He saw the vision. So while we're sitting around here trying to fight for a dollar, get your attitude right. I'm going to go, I'm done with this. Quit acting like you straight from the ghetto. I'm from the ghetto. I keep telling them all the time when they make me mad, I'm a decorated alabaster. Y'all just don't know. Don't let this shirt, don't let this fool you. I will come out of my war act. But thank God he purged me and molded me. He ain't so quick to ball up now. My mind ain't so quick to sit there and say, I guess when we get in the parking lot, I don't think like that no more. It's in there. I'm curious. You ain't curious. It's like a CD's in the back of your head. Let somebody know how to push that button. It's going to come right back up. You know, I don't cuss no more. Let somebody push that button, and you're going to cuss like a sailor. I'm trying to help somebody. Quit lying to yourself. Well, I'm healed. Yeah, you healed because you have been tested. Get tested, and we'll see if you heal or not. Going back to that bear dropping on that big toe. So I want to encourage y'all. After somebody give me 6 and 34 of Matthew, I want to encourage y'all. Don't jump off the bandwagon. Stay with the plan. It looks kind of glimsy right now. It's like a roller coaster. You start off sitting there waiting because there's a line of folk getting there, and you wonder when my turn going to come, and you finally get close to the thing, and your little cousin with you that's shorter than you, and realize, he said, oh, she can't get on. Then you're mad at this girl again because you don't want to get on the roller coaster by yourself. But finally, something going to get on it, and you get on it, and it's sitting there. It ain't moving. But when it starts moving, it's just gradually going. Something. This ain't bad until you get up and start going up and around and twisting and upside down, and you're going almost 100 miles per hour. Your wig fell off. Your chain fell out your pocket. You're sitting there and throwing up on everybody behind you, and you did everything else below the waist. You know, when you're scared, you're scared. Everything will come out. But at the end of the ride, you get off with some sanity. Two things are going to happen. I ain't getting back on that roller coaster. I'm going to go on forward. I'm going to do what I got to do. So we have to get to that place. Somebody give me Matthew 6:34. I can leave this alone. At the end of the day.
Do not worry about tomorrow.
Say that again. Do that again.
Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow. For tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble.
Ain't that something? He said, do not worry about who?
Tomorrow.
So that means today, if you think about tomorrow, shouldn't you be planning? If you know you got to go out of town, like me always, I find myself washing the day over the day before I leave. I don't know why I didn't do that. When I could have washed way before. But I didn't do it. I watched the day before. I just watched yesterday. I got to be out of town tomorrow. But that's just me. I guess it makes me sleep. But if you plan for today, you ain't got to worry about tomorrow. Because guess what? Tomorrow's not promised. That's when they talk about planning. I want to touch base on this before I get out of here. See you Facebook. You had enough. I'm closing. I was